what an honor it is to be part of this talented 12, and I look forward to meeting the other 11 throughout the day and getting to know them a bit better. I'll tell you a bit about myself. So I am from a little town called Rosemère, Quebec, which is a suburb of Montreal, Quebec in Canada. And what happened to me there is I learned how to speak French. And I didn't know it at the time, but it turns out that was really important for my career. I then moved to Ottawa, which is the capital of Canada, and I did my bachelor's degree at the University of Ottawa, and I did undergraduate research with Professor Susanna Scott, who's now at UCSB, and I worked in surface organometallic chemistry there. And then the following summer, I liked research so much, I decided to try my hand at organic chemistry and fell in love with the subject working in the lab of Bill Ogilvy. And so much so that I decided to do my PhD with André Beauchemin, becoming his first PhD student. And there we worked in hydroamination chemistry and in organocatalysis. So while I was waiting for some funding to come in for my postdoc, I spent 6 months working with John Pizzacchi at the NRC Canada in chemical biology and in bioorthogonal chemistry. So that was a nice experience. Finally, the funding came in, so I spent 2 really fun years in the group of Mike Crochet at the University of Texas at Austin, working in transition metal catalysis for carbon-carbon bond formation. And now I'm an assistant professor at the University of Strasbourg in beautiful Strasbourg, France, you should visit. And I work in the Institute for Supramolecular Science and Engineering, which is home to 3 Nobel laureates in chemistry. Okay. So some of the inspirations for my work came from the apparent differences that I would see between how chemists would do things and how life does things and probably how to do at its origins. And so, you know, as chemists, we buy really pure compounds from Sigma Aldrich or some other supplier. We work with them under highly controlled conditions. We exclude moisture. We exclude water. We try to keep things really controlled if we're doing catalysis because we don't want to poison our catalysts. But how does life do things? It works in water, it works in complex mixtures of gases, of minerals, and somehow it came up and evolved the most sophisticated and complex chemistry known to man. So there must be some value in working with complex mixtures, but what is it? And what features make a catalytic reaction competent in a complex mixture? These are questions that we don't usually ask ourselves. So those kind of naive questions led to a research program in my group, which I call a systems approach to catalysis. And one of the first things that we did was to develop a method for screening complex mixtures of catalyst components, such as metals and ligands. And once we figured out conditions where they enable catalysis, we can then deconvolute them to figure out which of those components contribute to the catalysis. And this is a good way to find cooperative effects. And so part of my team has applied this to discovering new methods for organic synthesis. And another part has worked on using it to identify conditions that may have been relevant to the origins of life. And that's what I'll talk about today. I also want to mention that we have a really cool collaboration with Professor Thomas Ebison, and it's at the interface of quantum optics and organic synthesis to try to develop a really new way to control reactivity and selectivity in organic chemistry. Okay, so back to this origins of life problem. This is a problem that's plagued chemists since 1953, when Stanley Miller first did his famous spark discharge experiments. It's a tough problem, and so I think it's useful to make some distinctions between the various levels of complexity that exist within life. So what life is doing at its fundamental level is it's interconverting simple geochemicals like CO2 and hydrogen gas into small molecule metabolites. And these then polymerize, and they can give you functional polymers like enzymes, which are great for catalysis and for structural properties. They can give you genetic polymers, which store life's information. But my research interests lie at trying to understand how that transition between the two lowest levels happened at the origins of life. How did we go from simple geochemicals to metabolism before there were enzymes? And this is a chicken and an egg problem because enzymes mediate that transition today in today's biology, and the information for making those enzymes is stored one level higher in genetic polymers. And so for this reason, some people think this pyramid's actually inverted with genetic polymers at its base. But I don't see it that way because I think you have to go from simplicity to complexity and not the other way around. And so one way to break that chicken and egg problem is to propose that simple inorganic catalysts mediated this transition at the origins of life. And there's another question. Well, if one of the things we're trying to explain in the origins of life is biochemistry, it makes sense to use biochemical pathways as models for that prebiotic chemistry. but which ones do we use? And so here it's useful to make some distinctions within metabolic organization. And one of these distinctions is that between reductive metabolisms and oxidative metabolisms. In other words, does our organism get its energy from taking in electrons from the environment or by giving them away to the environment? And there's a couple of reasons for thinking that reductive metabolisms probably predated oxidative metabolisms. The first is that there wasn't much oxygen on the early Earth. That's what geochemists tell us. But the second is that chemically speaking, these reductive metabolisms are kind of subsets of oxidative metabolisms and therefore probably came first. The second distinction is that between autotrophic organisms and heterotrophic organisms. That means, does our organism have a self-contained metabolism, but it can run all its own, or does it need to share its metabolism within a group or an ecosystem, like we do? So it makes sense that the origin of life, there wasn't already other organisms around to share a metabolism with, so autotrophs seem like better models. And so reductive autotrophs may be representative of early biochemistry. This is a view that's been taken by a number of lead thinkers in the field who I've put here, none of whom are experimental chemists, which is good for me. So autotrophs, they don't necessarily do photosynthesis. A lot of them get their energy simply by harnessing the naturally occurring redox gradient on the early Earth, or on the Earth. So what do I mean by that? Well, at its core, Earth's core is 80% iron zero. And then you go to the mantle, and you have mixtures of iron two and three within the iron-containing species. You go to the crust, you have iron three. And you go to the atmosphere of the Earth, and you have highly oxidized gases like oxygen, which means there is a redox gradient spanning the entire planet, or in other words, the entire planet's a giant battery. And just like the battery in your cell phone, this energy can be used to drive work and the forms of the metabolisms of these reductive autotrophs, and hopefully, maybe, or in the prebiotic chemistry on the early Earth too. All right, so there's six CO2 fixation pathways that life uses to build up its biochemistry that are known. Two of them are thought to be the most ancient, and these are the acetyl-CoA pathway and the RTCA cycle. And the acetyl-CoA pathway, you take a molecule of CO2, you reduce it down to carbon monoxide, you take another molecule of CO2, you reduce it to a methyl group, and then the two combine, forming a new carbon-carbon bond, and you get acetyl, which is normally bound to a cofactor called CoA. So this pathway is the shortest pathway of all the known ones. It's the only one that's linear. It's the only downhill pathway in terms of energetics, meaning that there's some versions of this pathway that don't require ATP to function. And it's found in both the major branches of the tree of life, which is the bacteria and the archaea. So it's probably very ancient. And indeed, a recent phylogenetic study concluded that this pathway was probably operating in the last universal common ancestor to all life. The other pathway is the RTCA cycle, and it's interesting because it contains all five universal precursors to biochemistry. So if you have acetyl-CoA, you can make lipids. If you have pyruvate, you can make alanine and sugars. If you have oxaloacetate, you can make aspartate and pyrimidines. If you have succinate, you can make pyrroles, which are important for cofactors. And if you have ketoglutarate, you can make many amino acids. So that's great. That's a nice property to have for biochemistry if you had all the precursors. It's also autocatalytic, meaning that it's self-amplifying. So one molecule becomes two, two becomes four, four becomes eight, so on. That's great. Exponential growth, nice thing for prebiotic chemistry. But the whole cycle is only found in bacteria, not the archaea, so only one of the branches of the tree of life. So it may or may not have been present in the earliest biochemistry, but the first six steps, starting from here all the way to here, are present in both branches. So they're probably very ancient too. So my lab's research interest then lies in wondering, could it be that these pathways are not just ancient biochemistry, but they're actually prebiotic chemistry, before enzymes altogether? And the reason for thinking this is that many of the enzymes in both of these pathways use transition metals in their active sites. Transition metals like iron, nickel, cobalt, and of course, coming from a catalysis background, those are great catalysts. So could it be that those reactions ran without enzymes in their kind of primordial form? So to try to answer that question, we bought a lot of equipment that we didn't have before and we got to work. And we tried a lot of stuff that didn't work, I'll be honest. But then we found something quite simple and fascinating. It turns out if you put metallic iron in water and you add CO2, you fix carbon dioxide on the surface of the metal and you form the same intermediates and end products of the acetyl-CoA pathway. You get formate, you get acetate, and you get also pyruvate. And you don't get much else. There's pretty much nothing else in there. And it's a very robust reaction. It works between 30 degrees Celsius and 100 degrees Celsius. It works between 1 bar CO2 and 35 bar. So it's a very robust reaction, which is something you definitely want to have for prebiotic chemistry. How about the RTCA cycle? Well, to tackle this problem, we divided the cycle into two pieces that doesn't actually include the entire cycle. It starts from oxaloacetate through three steps to succinate, and the second part of it starts from oxalosuccinate all the way through to citrate. And we looked for conditions that might promote these two arcs, and we found that, again, metallic iron does all of the reduction reactions of the cycle, and zinc 2 and chromium 3 mediate all the hydration and dehydration reactions of the cycle. So in other words, if these are all mutually compatible, so you can put them all together, and you can do this entire arc and this entire arc under one set of conditions without any enzymes. So if we add in the fact that CO2 fixation may include acetyl as an intermediate, that means 7 of the 11 reactions of the RTCA cycle work without enzymes under one set of conditions. And it turns out the same set of conditions would convert pyruvate into alanine, or keto acids into amino acids, just by adding in a bifunctional form of nitrogen, so like hydrazine or hydroxylamine. So this was quite exciting. You can do a good chunk of core metabolism without enzymes. Just as important as what does work is what doesn't work. So all of the ATP independent steps of these two pathways work without enzymes, but none of the ATP dependent steps work. And so that opens questions for future work. Was there a primitive form of ATP that was functioning at the origins of life, doing the same job from the very beginning, or is it a later invention? And perhaps there was actually alternative reaction networks that were ATP-free, or whatever that precursor was, that still produced the same five universal precursors to metabolism. This is a question that needs to be resolved in coming years. Another question is sugars. Where did they come from? And prebiotic chemists usually propose that the foremost reaction was critical for the formation of sugars in early life. That's the polymerization of formaldehyde, except that life doesn't do that at all. It uses a pathway called gluconeogenesis, which starts from pyruvate and builds up to sugar phosphates. And so we want to know, is there possibly a non-enzymatic gluconeogenesis that remains to be discovered? And we think this might be the case because Ralser and coworkers in Cambridge recently reported that a version of glycolysis, which is the reverse of gluconeogenesis, more or less, can be catalyzed just by iron too, and just by heating to 70 degrees. So maybe there's also a non-enzymatic gluconeogenesis. Okay, how about RNA? That's something we have to figure out. There's been a lot of great work by various groups around the world on the de novo synthesis of RNA, or ribonucleotides rather, but those are using pathways that don't look anything like biochemistry. Could it be that there's a version that looks a bit more follows the biological pathways? Well, it seems there is. Recently, Georges Lin and coworkers have reported salvage pathways that can be enabled just by silica at 70 degrees. So there may be, in the future, new ways to make RNA without enzymes that look very much like the biochemical pathways. So I hope this got you as excited about chemistry of the origins of life as I am excited about it. I have to thank the great postdocs and PhD students in my group who've worked on this project and also all the projects in my group. Thank you very much for all that effort and my great collaborators in the Institute and throughout the world. And of course, the European Research Council, which funds all of my research or a good chunk of my research. And finally, thank you.